and a neighborhood being gentrified, when the properties go, but the culture stays the same, or is it more gentrification when the culture is erased and must change?
Well, you know, as I said, I don't like using the term gentrification because it's such a fuzzy term. John Landis, who teaches in the planning department here, just published a big article in one of the planning journals in which he used the definition of income jumping up. But there are a lot of neighborhoods where that can happen with, you know, for me, the significant phenomenon is this issue of displacement. So for me, it's about people being pushed out of a neighborhood and other people coming into the neighborhood. We've been working with the policy department at Reinvestment Fund that you might be familiar with since you're working there. They're trying to come up with a measure that predicts neighborhoods that are at risk of displacement by looking at the income in the average incomes in the neighborhood compared to property values in the neighborhood, and to the extent property values are going up faster than income, it creates a pressure around displacement. The data I'm using really is looking back and saying, well, what are those patterns? So I mean, I think the problem with gentrification from my standpoint is that there are so many different ways of defining it that I prefer being a little more specific about what we're looking at. And again, if you look at the neighborhoods John's looking at, compared to the experience that the students in 200 are going through. You did Point Creek, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a very different set of neighborhoods. A different dynamic. In Harlem, and in several other neighborhoods in New York. Chicago to a great extent, what you're finding is what people are referring to as black gentrification, where essentially you have...
That's how it started in Chicago. Yeah. It started with black gentrification.
And I don't... In Philadelphia, I didn't see that as a major force yet. I mean, I think one of the reasons why so many traditionally African-American neighborhoods in the city are suffering declines in population is because I do think there's a tendency among African-Americans when they get to a certain economic level to move up to Mount Airy, to move to Cheltenham. You know, there, you're still seeing a suburban push there. So it's a little, it's, Philadelphia's a little different in that respect.
Social movement day and how just it's so difficult to like seize a moment and to really create a sustainable movement on a grassroots level, and then to not be coerced, right? To not have what you want to do become something that you really didn't even want to do. But now it sounds appealing because someone's showing you some money, right? Saying, well, we can do this. You really want to do that, but we'll pay for this. And now you're like, oh, and then the group's this because some people don't want to do that because they know that that's not what you organized to do, right? How do you do that and then bring that to an institution that can provide the resources? So it, again, sometimes I don't even think it's a negative sort of like, you know, conspiracy theory thing. Sometimes it's just very pragmatic. You know, like I have 5 kids. I'm not going to be at every meeting. I'm barely able to make this, right? And I think what got me was when I saw my name, and I'm like, oh, I'm definitely going to be there. You know, was co-sponsoring, was going to be there for half, but now I'm like, I'm committed to being there because now I'm on the panel, right? So I'm not going to be at the major community meeting because I'm going to be home teaching one of my kids something or making sure we're ready for school tomorrow, whatever that is. And that's just life. But again, it shouldn't just be about me. There's so many other people who are committed to the cause too. So that's why we're able to get some things done. But I just think sometimes we try to do too much and we don't get enough done. But sometimes we don't understand, like some of you all in the room wonder why you're here. You know, you guys are here because you're in class. Some of you are here because it was food. Some of you are here because this is important to you. So why are other people here? Right? And then even though you were here and you stayed and you were here for the whole talk, some people about to leave, which is fine, because you know that we all have other things to do. But it's like, what else can we do? What can you do with this information? Who are you going to connect with? And then how are you going to be able to prioritize that when also you have to get groceries tomorrow, right? Also the weekend is coming up. Like, there's all those realities. So it's just like, you know, again, how can we create an agenda and keep it very simplified, keep it very powerful, so that people will coalesce around that and we can get some things done. Sometimes this is a very pragmatic question.
I guess I...
I was going to ask that in the question that we have here. The common theme between up south and what the discussion about trust and how some community members don't necessarily trust the institution, don't trust the programs, don't trust Penn, because some of the things that have been happening. Did you ever have any findings on maybe some programs or initiatives?
Also, you know, poetry is interactive. You can like say something, snap, do whatever you want to do. They say Cape Town is a beautiful city. Make sure you climb Table Mountain, and on the other side of Table Mountain is a whole horizon of tin shacks. I mean homes. I mean people in their homes. You'd have to see to believe, you'd have to walk and watch. Observe this natural habitat. Let your guide translate another human's experience. Let your guide tell an entire people's story while the people are right there watching you silently. Black women stand in doorways eyeing this procession of foreigners. Black kids move their game a little closer for a better look. Some watch from inside their living rooms, from inside their storefronts, from the game table they set up with their boys. But we're not the first foreigners they've seen exploring their homes. And this is not the first township I've visited. We're just another page in the Rolodex of each other's life, normalizing these encounters. Encounters that are not encounters, just watching and translating. So I try to greet the people I see staring at me. Smile, nod, wave, smile, 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 wave, 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 smile. It must look as ridiculous as it feels, but I have to keep it up for all the history that's creating this moment. Making me the observer and them the observed, I have to keep it up for the people who seem surprised and quickly wave back. I keep wondering what they're thinking behind those stares, as if it even matters. as if they have any choice but to let us in, hoping some change will come from all this attention, all these visitors and their good intentions, but everyone already knows what's on the other side of the mountains. They come to see for themselves, to try and understand. It was exactly what they thought, and they already understood. Apartheid is not over. Apartheid most literally means separatehood, separateness, to be separate, to be mountains away in tin shacks, as if God's blood boiled at the thought of anything less, as if he pushed this earth up with his bare hands as high as he could, may his grace be with those that land on the right side. So whether we treat this like some journey for enlightenment or a trip to the zoo, it's all just a trip. And we're going back mountains away, oceans away, just a speck in a whirling hurricane of guilt and awe that will never move mountains, guilt and awe that can only quell the burning of a soul on the brink of knowing, the brink of seeing all this natural beauty. I left Cape Town in the pouring rain, nestled on a bus, taking in the last glimpses of this beautiful, tragic city. I saw a black man with no umbrella trying to sell newspapers on an empty street. I can still feel him standing there, even after the bus pulls away.
I'm finding so many different mentalities today. It seems challenging. I don't say hard because the only thing hard is the concrete that you walk on. Everything else is a challenge. So I'm ready for this challenge. And I was built for this.